We've got Goran Nitic going to be giving his presentation on boiling lava stars versus dark matter. And I guess if we're here, we're interested in what a star is and the theory of how stars are created and what they're really all about. And Mita's got an interesting theory. Of course, we have the hot fusion theory that's been predominant for since I started reading about space and physics and stuff like that. And then, of course, there's the electric universe theory that's come up in the last few years. But Mita's theory is maybe related to that a little bit, but it's definitely a distinct theory all on its own, and he's here tonight to explain it all to us. But we're going to start the show off with some music just to get us all relaxed. And Sarah Calvert is joining us here, and Sarah's written a song about, what's it about, Sarah?
Liquid boiling lava, of course. And incandescent gas, and all of those things I usually write about as a singer-songwriter.
Okay, great. Well, thanks for coming, and we'd love to hear the song.
Okay, great. Thank you. So before I play the anti-gravity song, I'll just let you all know a little bit about how Mita and I met. I was attending Songwriters of Canada seminar, Lauren Bathurst, some time ago last year, and I went in to Annapurna for lunch and a little break, whereupon I met Mita, and I had a name tag on, and he just inquired about why I was wearing a name tag, and I said, oh, I had a songwriter's seminar, and he said, oh, I need a songwriter, I've got this new theory, and I need a song. It was one of those serendipitous kind of moments. So over the past year, we've cultivated a relationship, and myself, coming from a very artsy-fartsy background, I studied English language and literature and French, Spanish, and I tend to shy away from physics, science, etc. I think I had my mom write me a note to get exempt from dissecting a frog in grade 9. So if I can understand this concept, I really feel like other people will be able to understand this concept as well. So this is the anti-gravity song. Well, here's a little tune with some new revelation that'll change everything we know. Well, it's the kind of thing that'll cause a sensation from Tokyo to Toronto. Way back in the day, we thought the world was flat, till someone dared to say, there's a problem with that. The truth lies not in thought, but lies in what is found. And with new discovery, we learn the world was round. Revelation, revolution, had to change the way we thought. Revelation, revolution, changed the things we taught. Feel free to, if you want to clap or dance or anything like that, just made up of gas, creating energy by fusion. Mita's got a brand new concept to grasp. Sun and stars, liquid boiling lava. There's no dark matter. We once thought the planet Earth was the center of it all,
Copernicus and Galileo made that theory fall. Now that we can see the sun, it's very plain to see. Find its true phenomenon is anti-gravity. Revelation, revolution, have to change the way we thought. Revelation, revolution, change the things we taught. Creating energy by fusion. We've got a brand new concept to grasp. Sun and stars, liquid boiling lava. There's no dark matter, you see. Sun and stars create air energy. Dark energy. All the stars are pulsing and they're hollow at their core. The planets too are hollow. And are you ready to hear more? Are you ready to hear more, people?
Yeah.
That's what the audience participation.
Sun is not the mass of incandescent gas. The sun is not the mass of incandescent gas. We now know the stars' illusions. Thought they were just made up of gas. Creating energy by fusion. Nina's got a brand new concept to grasp.
Sarah, before the show, that even Bruce Coburn used to write songs about geographical features on TVO. So she's writing about stars, so I'm sure we'll be listening to her hits on the radio, if radio's still around in a couple of years. Now it's time for Mita to tell us all about boiling lava stars. And Mita, welcome, and I'm just going to turn it over to you now. And I just want to say, before at the end of Mita's presentation, when I heard it the first time, I had a lot of questions and I had a lot of clarifications I wanted to make, and I wanted to get into a bit of a debate and a discussion, and we're all going to have that opportunity after Mita's finished. For if you want to come up and engage in a discussion, we'll get you up on the couch and we'll give you a mic, and we can actually get into a bit of a discussion about the subject. So Mita, take it away.
Thank you. Thank you very much to everybody who came here on this event. I'm Goran Mitic, physicist educated in ex-Yugoslavia. I came to Canada from Serbia, and I did a similar presentation in the middle of the summer this year here in Toronto in OISE Auditorium. But now my goal with this presentation is actually to start public debate, open public debate, boiling lava stars versus dark matter. According to Gandhi, there is four stages when you come with some good idea or something new. There is four stages. First stage is they ignore you. The second stage, they make fun of you. The third stage, they fight against you, and then you win if your idea is good. According to Arthur Schopenhauer, there is three different stages how we accept and acquire any knowledge. So first, any knowledge we acquired at any time in the past came to be ridiculed. After that, violently opposed, and after that, accepted like self-evident. What I'm going to talk tonight, it's self-evident, but that doesn't mean that it will go easily to accept that. So I would like to give you some perspective on some magazines. This is the Popular Science, November issue. Dark Matter says, inside the epic search for the fabric of the universe. At the beginning of this month, we had announcement from the last attempt to discover dark matter, that there is no any sign of dark matter yet. This experiment was 20 times more sensitive than the previous one, and now they're trying to build even more sensitive experiment to keep doing. But the thing is, what is really disturbing about everything, as we can see here, says dark matter makes up much of the cosmos, yet no one knows exactly what it is. Soon physicists may finally solve one of science's biggest mysteries. Shadow universe. All around us, a second reality binds the universe and gives it order. And this is even more disturbing. Dark physics could lead to dark stars, dark planets, even dark life. So we are going deeper and deeper into the darkness. But I'm here to question all that direction we took pretty long ago, almost 80 years ago, came idea about dark matter. How we came to that, we'll see soon. And this is the how it works magazine, also this month, and says 10 secrets of the space. And that says, first, most of the universe is missing. Second, the origin of cosmic rays is still unknown. Three, impossible stars. We have found impossible stars, which are impossible to exist by our theories, but they do exist. Four, the moon that shouldn't exist. So we see many, many, many things. Rectangular galaxies, number five. The rogue planet which just wander around. It's nowhere around the any star. Seven, the sun's corona shouldn't be hotter than its surface. And we will talk about that also tonight. The quest to find dark matter. Unpredictable quasars and galactic bubbles. So we see all the time many things which doesn't fit with the present theories. And all this presentation and start of this open public debate is to put in question everything which mainstream physics and what we call standard model tell us about the origin of the universe and the fabric of the universe. Is it really something mysterious, dark matter, or we just didn't see something very obvious? So when we look at the universe, what we see, we need first photo. So you will have a possibility to see photos on a screen, and I will give comment the first photo. When we see the universe, we see so far, we can see more than 100 billions of galaxies in the visible universe. And we estimate that every galaxy has approximately 100 billion stars. When we look at particular galaxy, which is on the photo number two, when we started to observe galaxies and to see how fast they rotate, what we have discovered is that they rotate too fast. According to our calculation and belief that stars are made of hydrogen, mostly hydrogen and some percentage of helium, creating energy by fusion of hydrogen to helium, there is no enough mass which can hold galaxy together. Because of such a speed they have, they will just fly apart by centrifugal force. So, conclusion came in 1930, by Swiss astronomer Zwicke, that must be something like dark matter, hidden somehow in a galaxy and keeping galaxies together. Otherwise, they will not exist. But we do see that they exist. So the whole concept of dark matter came to existence to explain how actually galaxies could rotate at such a speed if they have such a low matter in the stars. Even assuming that there is a black hole in the center of the galaxy, it doesn't work anyway, math doesn't work and doesn't show possibility that galaxies can stay together except if there is dark matter. And there is also dark energy, which is another dark thing which explains accelerating spreading of the universe, which was finally discovered in late 90s. Everybody was believing that universe must be slowing down in spreading because of gravity interactions. But then by trying to measure that slowing down, we have discovered that actually universe is accelerating its spreading. And nobody knew how to explain that. So another theory came that some dark energy now is responsible for faster and faster spreading of the universe. So we are getting same direction, bringing new dark things to explain things which we cannot understand. Every star has its own star system, planets and asteroids. So far, we have discovered more than 3 million extrasolar planets. So the planets around the stars are not exception in our solar system. So that's the rule. Pattern is the same. If our star has planets, that means every star has planets. And we have found now even billions of planets which are Earth-like with the possibility of life only in our galaxy. So we are getting there that we see that planets are everywhere around every star. And of course we have asteroids around the stars, and let us look at our solar system and see. You can see first big asteroid belt, which is between Mars and Jupiter orbit. Count of asteroid, there is a theory how they came to existence. We will not discuss about what all theory says, but just notice that there is big asteroid belt. And then also you can see asteroids in the orbit of Jupiter. So Jupiter also has some company of Trojan asteroids. So asteroids which are very close to our orbit, and we can see them very clearly and easily. But then, when we go further, another photo, please. What we have discovered here is that beyond the orbit of Pluto, there is the big asteroid belt, which we named Kuiper belt. It has a shape of a donut. It's beyond orbit of Pluto. But even it is so big, it's immensely small, it is that red one point you can see, inside a Oort cloud, which is huge cloud of asteroids, which basically circle around whole solar system. So we have asteroids which are basically stones, rocks, big rocks. We have rocks everywhere in our solar system. Not just that our, you know, first four planets are rocky planets, then we Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars, but also the planets, the biggest planets in our solar system, which we consider like a gas planets, which they are not, but we will come to that point also later. And Pluto and all these asteroids are basically made of liquid rock with a tiny cold crust. So when we consider what we see and we use a spectroscope, which we started to use even in the 19th century, end of the 19th century, and especially, you know, beginning of 20th century, we were looking in the sky, we were seeing hydrogen, helium, much less, and some other heavy elements, but mainly hydrogen everywhere. And that's correct. We see correct through spectroscopes. Hydrogen is everywhere. But that's the only one thing we have get about what makes the fabric of the universe. Yes, there is a lot of hydrogen everywhere. But as we can see, the theory and proposition of dark matter came to existence to explain missing matter. So there is something missing. What is that? What is missing? Fabric of the universe must be also everywhere. So let's use our own eyes, let's use also telescope like we were using to go through solar system, but let's now focus on Earth. What is the most common material on the Earth? It's rock. It's sand, rock. Yeah, but that's all rocks. That's all rocks. And when we go deeper, more rocks, stones, more rocks, and they are getting warmer. When we dig deep enough, we come to the liquid lava. What is actually material which builds this planet? And for that, we have a video. So let's go with the first video, please. So when we consider what the Earth is made of, we see this. Erupting lava, liquid stone. So cold stone on the surface and immense quantity of the liquid stone. We live on a liquid stone body, liquid rock. Just notice that liquid rocks erupted, you know, on a certain height, falls back down to the Earth, pulled by gravity force. No gases or fire follow this pattern. Gases and fire goes up, and no gas or no fire will fall down, you know, in a free fall. Only lava liquid falls down. So remember this, we will need this for later. But we have volcanoes on every planet, and we have even on our satellites. Jupiter satellites has active volcanoes. So we know that liquid lava is everywhere. So if we have a paradox. Paradox is that stars, which we consider made of hydrogen, creating energy by fusion of hydrogen to helium, are always surrounded with planets which are liquid lava with a cold crust and countless asteroids. If our sun make this pattern, planets, asteroids, then Kuiper belt, then Oort belt, that means that all stars do the same. And then we have full paradox that hydrogen gas star always has stones, liquid and cold around. How they came to existence? Present theory says, oh, we need explosion of sub-distant supernova, which will create heavy elements and send us, you know, here to our star, that our star will make its own system. That doesn't make sense. So let's take a close look at our sun. At least we can see one star very good. That's our star, sun. And now we have such a good equipment that we can really see what the sun is. When these theories came to be, the theory of that sun is a hydrogen gas body, we were using telescopes and spectroscope, we came to conclusion that it is gas body. We were able to see sunspots, but just barely to see sunspots, and that was one of the on the marks that sun is not solid body. But now we can see this. We can see this. And sunspots are always in the areas which are very bright. Sunspots are actually erupted lava from sun's volcanoes, heavier lava, which came from the deeper layers, came to the surface. It's just 20% less bright than photosphere. But it's enough to see that it is like, appears like a dark. But even this photo shows that this is not a gas. That all this part is easy part to understand. That sun is not a gas, that it is liquid lava, because it is visible. Another photo, please. This photo shows differential rotation of sun. So by observing sunspots, we were able to measure speed of rotation of the sun. And we measured that sun rotates, needs 25 days to make full rotation at the equator, and need 35 days to make full rotation close to the pole. That was the first proof that sun is not solid body. So that sun is either liquid or gas, but not solid. Because if we consider cold crust of the planet, we have same speed of rotation. So what else? Another photo, please. This is photo from my book, and shows the Doppler effect photo. When we, on the right side, you see the Doppler photo. When it is translated into the 3D, we come to this shape. So our sun in 3D looks like this yellow part on the screen, which doesn't look like a gas. Looks like something liquid with the waves, oscillating with the waves on top. So that's another thing which shows that it is liquid. Another, please. And then we have this photo. This photo is actually made of two photos. We can see, when we cover the body of the sun, we can see corona. When we cover corona, we can see body of the sun. So, but this photo is made of two photos together. And it's perfect to show us the difference between the body of the sun and the atmosphere of the sun. Atmosphere of the sun is obviously gas. It's visible. It's streaming out, making solar wind. But it's clearly visible that body of the sun is in a different phase. It's liquid. Another one, please. And this is also photo made of basically joining two photos showing coronal mass ejection, which is basically ejection of the gases from the sun. Again, showing that streaming gases and sun's corona are gas, and how they look and what is the body of the sun. Again, shows clearly that it is different phase, that it is liquid. And now from the images, we will go to the videos. We have very good videos about the sun now, made from NASA stereo mission. There is SOHO, there is Solar Dynamic Observatory. We closely watch sun every day, and we can see very clearly what's going on the surface. The point is just to recognize what we are looking at. And maybe go with the second video, please. Now we will see what's going on the surface of the sun. Okay, the material which is pulled fast goes away, but there is the material falling back to the surface of the sun at the free fall. And I want to remind you about the volcano video we were seeing. Only liquids fall back down in a free fall. No gases, no fire, no hot gases. They don't ever fall down in free fall to the surface of the body. So we clearly see explosions. What the exploded lava, which has enough speed to leave gravity field of the sun, flies away. But the rest of the lava, which doesn't have that speed, is pulled back to the surface, to fall on the surface, and falling back in a free fall. And what we see, this is how gases are created, how corona is created, and you can see how fast are they. But these are gas. That's atmosphere of the sun. And we see explosions and streaming of the solar wind from the sun. Every star does the same. Every star has star wind, blowing everything away. Nothing in a form of dust can come and condensate around our star, because every star, or any other star, because every star blows everything away with its gas, with its own solar wind. So the theory about that some other supernova distant will bring something here to help our sun or any other star to create planets is just impossible. We can go with the next video, please. The video. So the thing is, we can see the sun now, but we have a psychological problem. If we believe that it is gas and we talk about magnetic fields, we see what we believe. The thing is just to wake up and to realize that we are looking at the liquid boiling lava. You can see how lava goes up and down, because this is just eruption like volcano. That eruption doesn't have speed to leave the gravity field of the sun. So everything stays on a certain height, but lava comes back. And now we have this amazing loop created, and just watch what's going on. What is falling down? If fire and hot gases cannot fall in a free fall, then just liquid can fall like this, dropping back from that loop. Of course, you always have to imagine that this is the sun rotates, that these loops are created because of rotation of the sun. So it is the same thing. If you throw something very high because of rotation, it will not fall on the same spot. So we clearly see that liquid just dropping down. So what I'm talking about is obvious, is visible. The thing is just to recognize, just to wake up and to see that the material which was missing was all the time in front of our eyes. It's rock, it's lava from volcanoes, it's lava boiling on the surface of the sun. If our sun is boiling, like liquid boiling lava, then every star is liquid boiling lava. Pattern is always the same. and you see the surface, it's just a sea of boiling lava with many eruptions, but this one was really amazing, and it's captured because of that, and it's exactly perfect example to show how liquids dropping down, because it's liquid lava just ejected and now falling down after that. Because, you know, that eruption doesn't have enough speed and energy to eject lava to leave the surface of the sun. If lava can leave the surface of the sun, it creates, if it is small eruption, creates asteroids. If it is big eruption, can create a planet. So that's the pattern. And you can see this try to launch and then falling back down. Just visible. The thing is to wake up. What I'm trying to do with this, just to wake up. Say, people, what are we looking at? It's liquid magma, lava. And when we bring that to the table, then we don't need dark matter. Because dark matter came to existence. If we have gas star made of hydrogen, then we need dark matter to keep all the stars in the galaxy. If we have liquid stars of magma, of lava, then we don't need dark matter. It's that simple. It's that simple. And we have one more video, please. And this is the tri eruption. It tries to launch material as high as possible, but then you see how everything coming back, because there is no enough speed to leave gravity field of the sun, it's pulled back and coming back to the surface of the sun. That can happen only with the liquid, never with the gas. It's that simple physics. So stars are liquid boiling lava. That's huge conclusion, new huge conclusion. But we have a problem. We have a problem. Now, from the missing matter, we have too much matter. Because if we just replace hydrogen with liquid stone, then we are coming to too much. So far, we measure that if we believe that stars are hydrogen, then we see just 4 to 5% of the matter in the universe. 20-something% is dark matter, and everything 70-something is dark energy. That's the consistency how we now see the universe. But when we switch from hydrogen stars to liquid lava stars, then we come to another problem, that then we have too much matter now. So there is something missing. We didn't get exactly what the stars are, how they really function, how they're really built. So for this problem, we have to do experiment. And that experiment we will do right now, and we will go to the space station Mir and do experiment there. So we have a video from the space station showing one experiment done there, and you will see why it is important. So maybe have a video, please. And can we have a sound now? Zero gravity.
Does of these air bubbles as a function of time. What you're observing are the bubbles moving to the center axis of rotation. As a function of time, they will form this rather tightly packed bubble core. These bubbles are kept from coalescing from a small amount of added surfactant to the water. Here we have a rotating sphere filled with bubbles and tea leaves. And as expected, the bubbles go to the center and the tea leaves go to the outside edge, along with a few chunks of orange peel. Here we have a rotating sphere with bubbles and chunks from breaking up a small vitamin tablet, and the bubbles go to the center core, but the vitamin chunks seem to stay in their location, dispersed through the sphere, and from this we deduce that the vitamin chunks have a density near that of water. Here we have
Okay, thank you. For me, this video was needed to see this video to understand what's going on inside the stars. This is the experiment done on in zero gravity environment on a space station near water, liquid, and gas, air bubbles, how they rotate together. So you have seen what happened during the experiment. Now I would like to explain very simple physics which make this experiment, why it is so. So when we go with a picture which goes like a 100, yes. So when we look at this, so the circle is water, and we have a bubbles which after rotation comes to the core. Why they do that? So we have two forces in action. We have gravity force, which tried to hold everything and to pull everything together. And we have centrifugal force. Due to rotation, we always have centrifugal force, which tries to push everything away from the axis of rotation. So these two forces create pressure in this water. And this curve, P, is the pressure curve. As further we are from the axis of rotation, the centrifugal force is stronger. It makes bigger pressure. As we approach to the axis of rotation, the pressure is less. That game of the forces of gravity and centrifugal force makes all bubble coming to the central core, to the axis of rotation. So this is the simple physics which explains how liquid and gas rotate together in zero gravity. Now, when we apply this to liquid boiling lava, that means boiling means creating bubbles, gas all the time. Due to the rotation, we will come to the next. Can we have next? Yes. This is how really star looks like from inside. So the same principle which we saw with the water, cold water and bubbles, because we have boiling, that means always bringing new bubbles, creating more and more gas. So we will have that chamber will be created inside the star, and of course there will be pressure always increasing, which has to release somehow, to be released, or star will explode. But we don't see that all star has exploded, so they exist. So what will happen? How that pressure will be released? The same principle of creating bubbles around the axis of rotation makes North Pole and South Pole of the star weakest points. Of course, gravity tried to close, and because it is very heavy, it's liquid stone, try to close that openings, but the pressure from the chamber must be released somehow, and it is released exactly on the weakest points. So that pressure is released either through North or South Pole, or basically simultaneously to both poles, there is the release of the pressure from inside the Sun. So what we really have in this area, which is red, you can see like a body of the Sun, there is the boiling on the surface of the Sun, outer surface, which is outer solar wind, create outer solar wind. And we also have boiling of the inner surface, which create inner solar wind. So we have explosions all the time inside the sun, creating new gas. And it works like a, this is also rotating because star rotates, it's like a wheel. It's a furnace which really heats up the sun from inside. And that pressure must be released somehow and goes up and down. So not that stars are just liquid boiling lava, they're hollow inside. When we understand that, then we are coming to the real quantity of the matter in the universe. Then we don't have too much matter, because stars are liquid boiling lava, but they all have hollow inside, with the openings which pulsate according to release of the pressure on the north and south pole. And do we see this? Yes, we do. We can see on our sun that solar wind coming out on north and south pole is at least 3 times faster than solar wind created on any other part of the surface. So we already see, we call that phenomena polar brushes. We see that streaming of the gas is much faster on the north and south pole of the sun. What else we can see? Looking at the universe, we see the stars which we call pulsars. We name them like separate category. But what we actually see is among the billions and billions of stars, some of them we see from the point of view of their north or south pole. And we see that openings and pulsation, what I was talking about on this sketch. So we see that, but we don't realize that that stars we see from the north or south pole of their own existence, we believe that they are separate category of stars. Basically, all stars work on same principle. If we go with our own suns, if we send some satellites up or down the sun to see the north or south pole, we will see the same. We will see pulsating of north and south pole. So all stars are pulsars. Of course, depending on the edge of the star, pulsation will be different. And pulsation of the star can give us exactly the age of the star. That can vary from the totally close north and south pole, totally without any pulsation, to beginning what we see like explosion, novas and supernovas, is basically moment of opening of this process. So that's the first opening, that when explosion is the biggest one, when star first time opened that wells to release the pressure. And it can go faster and faster to the moment when the pressure inside will be so big and creation of the gases will be so huge that openings will be constantly open and the gas will constantly stream out of the star. So observing these phenomena, we can exactly see what is the age of the certain star. But not just the stars are hollow, also planets are hollow. So maybe here another photo, please. This is planet. So according to same principle, planets came to existence after eruption from the sun, and from the dead very beginning of creation of the planet and rotation, the chamber is created. But because surface get cold, the opening stays open, because planet has cold surface, so the openings are always open. With the stars, we have hollow inside and pulsation. To majority of the stars, pulsation of the north and south pole. With the planets, we don't have pulsation, because they are covered with a cold crust, but they are also hollow. Only small objects like asteroids and very small planets can be without hollow. But all bigger planets, including Earth-like planets, and of course 4 big planets, are hollow. Same pattern like with the stars. So we have hollow liquid lava universe. We don't need dark matter. We just have to realize that we missed material which is everywhere around. As we assume that our dark matter is everywhere, stones are everywhere. Even our very bodies are made of part, you know, we have bones, and then unfortunately some make more stones and then go to the doctors to get rid of the stones. But stones are everywhere. That's the material we missed. And we also missed the purpose of the hydrogen. So we see hydrogen everywhere. And hydrogen is everywhere, between the stars, in the galaxy, between the galaxies. But hydrogen doesn't make any contribution to gravity. Hydrogen does exactly the opposite. Hydrogen does the contribution to anti-gravity. Because, as Sarah said in the song, fire is anti-gravity phenomena. What we have missed to realize, to recognize here on Earth, is that fire is anti-gravity phenomena. And when stars create energy, they the evaporation of the temperature of the surface of the sun, photosphere, is 5,800 or less degrees. And then when we go up in photosphere, come to 20,000-30,000 degrees, and in corona comes to few million degrees. That's absolutely not logical. When you go away from the source of the heat, that you're getting higher and higher temperature. But that makes sense if we understand that gases which came to existence from the boiling lava are so hot, at least some percentage of them is so hot, that they have repulsive mass. And they are rejected by anti-gravity force from the sun. Exactly as we have attraction between two attractive masses, we have repulsion between attractive and repulsive mass. When I say repulsive mass, that comes from the realization that mass is relative according to temperature. We know that many, almost everything we know is relative to the temperature, but we assume that mass is not. But when I say that, I don't confront with Einstein, because Einstein's theory of relativity says mass is relative according to speed. But we also know from molecular kinetic theory that speed and temperature are inseparably interconnected. So when I say mass is relative to the temperature, I don't confront Einstein. There is misunderstandings with the math, but there's another step. Okay. So the thing is that we didn't understand that hydrogen, which came to existence from the thermal decay of the heavy elements. So magma is liquid stone. The vapor from the liquid stone is also made of heavy elements. They have repulsive mass. They are repulsed by sun, speeded up to such a speed and such a temperature that they have to decay. They decay to the Telmer process, decay to the hydrogen and alpha particles, protons and alpha particles. And we see them like a hydrogen and helium, but they are just end of the decay of the heavier elements which started from the liquid lava vapor. And then what we see like a hydrogen everywhere exactly has repulsive mass. It's too hot. It has repulsive mass. And hydrogen with the repulsive mass and anti-gravity effect is the dark energy. That's the thing, that's the process which spreads and pushes everything away, galaxies away. Because stars make hydrogen through speeding up the heavy elements and decaying them to the protons, creating solar wind. Because temperature on the surface is let's say 6,000 degrees, corona few million degrees. So decay to the speeding up by anti-gravity force, warming them up, decaying to the hydrogen and basically protons and alpha particles, and then they do anti-gravity job. They spread everything. Of course, galaxies are kept away by strong gravity force, because liquid stone still has gravity force, it's liquid, has attractive mass, but in a gas state, it can have, if it is hot enough, it can have repulsive mass. So the hydrogen, the role of the hydrogen in the universe is exactly to spread the universe. So the dark energy is anti-gravity force, which is based on the repulsive mass of hydrogen created by stars. Stars create hydrogen. Hydrogen doesn't create stars. Stars create hydrogen through this process of anti-gravity repulsion of the vapor of the liquid stone and making solar winds. So hydrogen with the hot hydrogen with the repulsive mass is the what we call dark energy. That is the process which is responsible for spreading universe faster and faster, because every star at every moment creates solar wind. It's like a pump, pumping gas into the universe. All galaxy creates galaxy wind, which pump galaxy wind into the universe, and galaxy spreading away faster and faster because more and more hydrogen with the repulsive mass coming in between. That's the story. And now we have a video for the end, animation, about how actually things are going on. So this is the liquid axis of rotation, rotating star, and then we have openings when gases are released, and that's the pulsation of the north and south pole. And also, with dead gases comes also some storms. But this is point of view of the north pole or south pole. So what we see burst of gases, but also we see the stones coming with the gases out, up. So what will happen during the time from the explosions from the surface will be created Kuiper belt. From the explosions from the north and south pole opening will be created Oort belt or cloud, because they are much faster. They have more speed, they will get, you know, bigger radius. So this pattern is everywhere in the universe. Every small star, like our sun, creates its own system like this. If star is very big, will create galaxy. This will be pattern for galaxy. Can be like a Kuiper belt, can be like Milky Way, or in some other circumstances can be global galaxy like Oort cloud. So pattern is the same. Small stars like our star create exactly planets and Kuiper and Oort belt of asteroids as we have. If it is the bigger star, and there is a lot, much, much, much bigger star than our star, is very small star. Very small star. There's giants in the universe. So such a stars, they create galaxies in the same process as a star creates its own system. Pulsation to north and south pole, that material thrown to the north and south pole is much, is pushed, rejected much further away, creates the, what we call Oort belt, so that's like a global galaxy. Or if it is from the surface of the sun, outer surface, then it creates Kuiper belt or create like a dome galaxy, what we call spiral galaxies. And this is what I'm talking, simple, it's logical, and it's obvious. So let's switch from the something which is very complicated, which is not logical, and which is not obvious, like hydrogen stars, hydrogen universe, dark matter, dark energy, and many other dark things. Let's go to the simple, logical, and obvious things, which says that stars are liquid boiling lava, hollow. This is the hard part, as I said, to understand what's going on inside. And for that, I needed 16 years to get to that point. And this video was really crucial to understand what's going on. I knew that stars are hollow inside because of anti-gravity force, just I didn't understand how they really work. That video gave me final clue and key how to understand what's going on inside the stars. And we see the pulsars. And we can send the sounds our satellites and to see sun from the north and south pole. But we see already that there is streaming of gases much faster than, so we see the differences. So what I'm talking about is visible. We see it now. We just have to put things in place. Thank you very much. I'm inviting you now to debate about this. Thank you. This is just the beginning of the debate, but just by changing position of the sun from the geocentric to heliocentric system, Copernicus. Mm-hmm. This debate about that was 150 years long. Just geometry. Mm-hmm. Now we are talking about not geometry, we are talking about chemistry, we are talking about physics, and we are talking about new energy process, how star create energy. We are bringing anti-gravity to the table. I don't know, we can debate 150 minutes or 150 years. But what I'm talking about is just obvious. At the end of discussion, will be accepted like self-evident.
I was just going to say, what's the current NASA explanation for those solar flare pictures?
Let's start with the thing debate, you know.
Sure.
Okay, Mita, thanks. Richard, so we've heard the presentation now, and we're going to have an opportunity, like Richard has a question, and there's lots of, it's very thought-provoking, the stuff that Mita is bringing up. So what we're going to do is just, whoever wants to come up and engage in a conversation about this, we'll do it right here, up here on the couch. Richard, if you want to come on.
Sure.
I'm just going to unplug this for a second. Don't worry, we'll fix it all in editing. Okay, so here we are. So, Richard, what were you going to ask there?
Well, I was just going to ask because I agree that it is obvious, from a visual standpoint, that something that very much looks like, a volcanic eruption that we're all used to seeing from growing up and seeing those are happening on the sun. And now that we can see it with better technology, it seems pretty clear. What's the NASA explanation for what we're seeing and why they haven't made the same leaps?
NASA still stays with the standard model, which says that sun is a hydrogen body, mm-hmm. gas body. But I didn't see that program. But my friend told me that probably was on Discovery that NASA was mentioning some layers of lava in some new animations about how sun can work. Also, as I know, NASA has a project to launch satellite which will crash into the sun. So the goal is to go as close as possible, to record as much as possible, and to see whenever it is burnt, but to get as close as possible to the sun. So the thing about really what the sun is coming to the point now, to the table, to see if something is wrong. There is plenty of young cosmologists which see that something is fundamentally wrong. Not just young, there is also many, many serious scientists which see that something is seriously wrong with our universe, with present understanding. Let's elaborate a little bit on that, what's wrong. Many of the stars are older than we calculate our universe is old. By the same procedure of calculation, we are getting that the universe is younger than some of the stars. And we come to paradox that mother is younger than daughters or children. Then we came to faster and faster spreading of the universe, which is also was totally something unexpected. And then we come to the missing matter, which we call dark matter. So it has a lot of problems. So yes, NASA trying to figure out, they also work on that something has to be changed.
Yeah, and your theory seems to solve a lot of these problems that really don't make a lot of sense, like the dark matter issue. And even that, I mean, one of the things that's convincing for me about Mita's theory is that NASA experiment on the space station, showing where the bubbles, the conflict between the centrifugal force and the gravitational force, I mean, that actually makes sense. And we've heard rumors about the hollow Earth, and people laugh at that, but maybe there's something to it.
Well, that actually made me think, too, while you were talking about that, because like you said, hollow Earth theory is not only not new, but it's controversial because it's considered fringe stuff. It's considered sort of out there. Yet, obviously, if you go back into ancient civilizations, it's actually quite, you know, quite a normal part of that. But it made me wonder, and I don't know if you have the answer to this, Mita, as to why there's been so little exploration. And it's interesting because you hear people talk about this in the spiritual world. You know, we're always doing, you know, we're going into outer space instead of inner space, you know, where the answers are inside us. Well, in the same way, it's interesting to me that we're looking at the planets, we're looking at the stars, yet we haven't done what you would expect in terms of real scrutiny on the inside of this planet. Why do you think that is, or are they planning, like, is there a reason, is it too dangerous to go to the center of the Earth? Like, why wouldn't we have done way more sort of experimentation on the inside of our Earth?
I think it's secret, they've done it. It's underneath the Denver airport,
yeah.
Right? But they don't want to let people in on it.
Okay, as I know, there's some cruiser going, like, to go to explore the possibility of inner Earth.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I heard about a cruise, like you could book a ticket on a boat that was going up by Alaska trying to find the entrance to the hollow Earth. Just a couple of years ago.
But I even mean it from a standpoint of even like from an industrial standpoint. Obviously, we have a pretty insatiable appetite to go looking for wherever we can find minerals or whatever we can. You would think by this time in our history, we would have drilled so deep into the Earth and there'd be elevators going up and down in terms of what we'd be doing. Because again, we usually go where the source of the money is, and there's got to be way more minerals at that level. Yet you just don't hear, you know, people essentially just cracking the surface. But it would seem to me that we would know much more about the Earth itself than we do.
As you care, you have a possibility to see through my presentation, our understanding of universe in global is totally wrong. Mm-hmm. It's totally wrong. So we didn't understand what the sun is, we didn't understand what the earth is, we didn't understand our universe. We were seeing hydrogen, but we didn't understand that hydrogen is responsible for repulsion of the galaxies and spreading the universe apart. And we didn't get even clue that that can be liquid boiling lava. So now we are coming to the point to build totally new understanding of the universe. And this is like some base given to this presentation, and huge work is open now. This is just the opening of the huge work for generations, which will have to rebuild everything again to make sense, to be simple, logical, and obvious what we are talking about in our theories.
I have a question, though, because when we saw that very first video of a volcano, okay, and we saw that there was a man in front of it, so we could see that. And when we see the images of the sun, yes, it looks like a volcano, but there's so many levels of filters on that for us to be able to see the detail of what's happening on the sun. When we look at the sun in the sky, we're 93 million miles away. It's so bright, we can't even look at it. So something is making that star much brighter than just boiling lava. If that was boiling lava, yes, like what we're used to on the Earth, we wouldn't be able to look at a volcano.
What do you think that is, then? What
would you say? I don't know. This is my question.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Okay. If sun doesn't work like as I showed in the presentation, the surface of the sun, we can measure that. It's 5,800 or less than that 1,000 degrees. So 5,800 degrees, that's nothing. We can make that temperature here on Earth easily now. So how come that we have increase of temperature in the photosphere? When we go away from the sun, we have increase to 20 to 30,000 degrees in photosphere, in the chromosphere. And then further away in corona, we go to million or few million degrees. So that's the thing. So anti-gravity process, which repels the vapor from the stones, with the repulsive mass, speeding up dead molecules to that such a high temperature and disintegrating them to alpha particles and protons, which we see like a hydrogen and helium. So our seeing is correct, but our understanding is wrong. So the anti-gravity process, the way how it really starts creating energy by anti-gravity, it's responsible why the sun is so bright. And it is much more effective process than nuclear fusion, which we were wrongly, you know, bringing to the...
So you're saying that the anti-gravity, which is part of this whole process, is converting that rock that's the boiling star,
evaporating rock,
evaporating it into hydrogen and helium that we see as the solar wind.
Yes.
Right?
But, you know, as we can see, the sun like a body, hollow body, but it's still boiling on a very low temperature. It's boiling on, let's say, 6,000 degrees. Mm-hmm. But by anti-gravity force, create corona with few million degrees, mm-hmm, and radiating huge energy into the space.
And so, yeah, I don't entirely understand why what's the explanation for the massive gap in temperature at that higher level. Like when you get to a million degrees, is that because it's trapped at that point? That, you know, the solar flares or whatever is escaping and then being, like, how is it so heated at the coronal level?
Is that actually the corona dissolves in a solar wind? Mm-hmm. So it blows away from the sun everything and then spreading much further than the solar system. So it's going beyond the boundaries of the solar system. Mm-hmm. And that's just the beginning. So a few million degrees in corona, and after that temperature again decreases slowly, but that's the process which is actually created by work of anti-gravity force. So what I'm bringing with this, I'm bringing missing force to the physics, mm-hmm, anti-gravity force, which is really missing force. We all believe and we expect to find anti-gravity force. We just didn't realize that fire, we were looking at the fires all the time. Mm-hmm. So apples are falling down. That was Newton's Eureka. Yeah. My Eureka was looking at the fire and realizing that that's the anti-gravity phenomenon.
The flame's going up.
The flame goes up, and everything what goes up, we you know, attribute to the...
That's really interesting.
Yes, to the Archimedes' law. But fire is not Archimedes' law. It's very simple to explain. If fire, flame, is Archimedes' law, then shape of the flame will be like a harp as we draw the harp. But the shape of the flame is always open. One more proof that fire is anti-gravity phenomenon. The astronauts which were in the satellites traveling around the Earth were seeing aboriginal fires, Australian aboriginal fires, which they have like a rituals. Mm-hmm. So certain month in the year, they keep the huge fire burning whole month. Burning huge quantity of wood, and in their beliefs they want to say hello to some civilization extraterrestrial which visited them long ago. They want to say hi, we didn't forget you. Mm-hmm. So that's their belief. We don't go to,
sure,
we don't want to,
it's
go that
show
way.
Yeah.
But the astronauts in the satellites were seeing that fire coming all the way up to the orbit of their, you know, trajectory. In so rare atmosphere, which is almost zero pressure up there, it's impossible to have fire if it is Archimedes' law, because there is no atmosphere to support it. Archimedes' law only works in the fluids. So fire is anti-gravity phenomena, because that hot flames, gases, are pushed all the way up to that height by anti-gravity force.
That's true. They actually saw flames going up to the orbital level. Wow, that is amazing. Any other physicists in the house, or anybody else have any questions or want to come up here? And do you want to come on up? I think this fellow has been waiting over here. Richard, do you want to take it or?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, sure. Okay. I'll come on over and I'll give you a the mic and Richard can moderate.
Hi guys, I brought my trusty technology with me. because we just need a little bit of help, you know, with all this stuff. I wrote down a couple of questions along the way, and one of the things I heard you talk about, Mitta, is that there's an opening in the planet, that we consider it to be a hollow planet. And so one of the questions I had on that is, if indeed it's a hollow planet, how can we explain the poles shifting? Would they not be fixed if the planet was fixed itself and then the opening is in a certain place?
If we understand that not just the stars are hollow, but also the planets are hollow, we have to change everything what we now consider we know about the structure of the planet and the origin of the magnetic field. So there is no core of the planet, there is no core of the star. It's hollow. So the whole process how they create magnetic fields, stars or planets, is something different. I don't say that I have all the answers, but I say something which is logical, simple, and obvious.
Well, you don't debate the poles shift still?
No. I don't debate about that.
Okay.
There is shifting poles, also stars. We have now our sun has to shift poles, magnetic poles.
Momentarily, isn't it?
Yeah, everything is in cycles. So everything stays for a while in cycles, and then as planets shift the pole, also stars shift the pole, magnetic poles. So there is the cycle that I cannot explain everything, but the mechanism how they make magnetic field is totally different than we can even imagine so far. So we have to find out.
Is there any possibility in your theory that magnetic fields are affected by anti-gravity?
What I'm bringing anti-gravity force, but we have to understand that in the universe, all the forces work all the time together. So gravity keeps galaxy together. Then there is the hydrogen created by stars, which brings anti-gravity, and also the process of creation of energy is anti-gravity force in the action. Of course, protons and alpha particles are charges, electrical charges. They create currency. Whenever we have flow of currency, we have magnetic field. So magnetic field, electrical field, gravity field, anti-gravity field, everything work together all the time. That's the point. We have to take all of them in account all the time, not just gravity.
That's a good answer. It's a better answer than I could come up with. I don't know much about these things. As a matter of fact, I go around these days saying I actually know nothing. But I do come up with an occasional question. One of the other questions I had is if our stars and our sun creates planets, then shouldn't our sun continue to decrease in mass?
There is the process which, you know, because of evaporation of the basically stone, that decrease the mass, and also ejection of the liquid material which creates asteroids or planets in some big explosions, yes, that decreases the mass of the star. But that process is much, much, much slower than the process we now assume, like hydrogen fusion. So far we assume, by theory of hydrogen fusion, we assume that our star can live 10 billion years. By understanding this much more effective process of creating of energy, that means that stars are much older and that they are going to live much, much longer. So the whole theory about origin and the time length of the universe must be changed.
So would we see stars that are decreasing in mass at all? I understand you said that the mass is related to temperature and they get hotter. So I'd imagine if they heat up, then they would expand more, but that wouldn't increase their mass, it would just increase their volume. Is that right?
It will increase their volume and attractive mass will decrease. But that, because of loss of conservation of momentum of rotation, it will increase their speed of rotation. So everything is connected. And this increasing speed of rotation will also increase the inner process which creates faster pulsation of the north and south pole. So as everything is connected, so as we, like a universe, why universe is spreading? Because getting warmer and warmer and warmer. Because by warming up the universe, attractive mass get decreased. But that means speeding up of everything. Time is going to be, is already speeded up and speeding up because of energy constantly coming.
Is that something we can measure, that the increasing the speed of time?
Yes, we can measure, and there is the frequency of the Earth, which was like 7.8 hertz in, let's say, late 70s or early 80s. Now it's more than double. So we can measure that frequency of Earth.
It's been theorized before, too, with stuff like singularity theory and whatever, but it's also been written about recently, because I've had this discussion with people just on a sort of anecdotal level that, wow, isn't time going faster? And people generally say, oh, we're getting older, there's technology.
It's experienced that way.
But I definitely believe that there's something going on that, like you said, is it measurable? Because it would be very difficult to measure while you're in it.
Mm-hmm. Because it's subjective.
But I mean, if I had a gun to my head and I had to be right with the answer, I would say time is sped up. And
when there's a gun to your head, my experience is that it slows down.
It's not just subjective, feeling that time is speeding up. Time really physically actually speeding up. Because we are getting more and more energy in the system. Whenever we are getting more energy in the system, we have faster motion. Whenever we have faster motion, time going faster. Everything is connected.
The last question I have written down here is, do we see any evidence today that stars create planets? Like, is it still going on? And if it is going on, as you say, shouldn't there be some stages that we can see that this is happening right now?
It's obvious that planets are created by their own mother stars. So all planets and asteroids, which create some certain, star system, are created by mother star. The galaxy is created by the mother of the galaxy. So there is always mother star in the center. And that process, of course, going on. And we are discovering more and more extrasolar planets. And to certain explosions, we will finally capture the one day creation of some planet.
And my guess too would be here that we're limited in terms of what we can ultimately see and measure. I mean, even with the telescopes that are out there right now, we're still, we're measuring planets and we're deciphering where planets are by, their mass, compared to the star that they're in. Like, it's not like we're literally, pointing out and looking at things and seeing, because I would suspect at some point soon we're going to launch even better. And that's to me what a lot of this is about, whether it's the macro level or the micro level. Everything just gets revised when we come up with a new measurement instrument. Mm-hmm. It is interesting to me that we haven't realized that yet. Yet we have this sort of collective arrogance to then draw a new line and say, okay, we figured everything out. Until we have a new microscope that goes deeper or a new telescope that goes further, and then we're like, oh, well, as it turns out, we weren't right. And it seems that what we don't talk about enough at the micro and macro level is this idea of infinity, because there seems to be, at least from an outsider's perspective, a lot of relationship between what you're talking about and, I see an atom. When you look at, the hollow earth theory, and I think to myself, well, that seems to sound a lot like, a nucleus in the middle of an atom and the electron. And it seems like there's a lot of relationship between the micro and the macro. Is it ultimately something we're going to figure out that, that's what's, there's something beyond our scope to be able to understand?
That's an interesting note. I saw a particular animation where it went from the macro down to the micro. And by the time you went from the macro and looking at the universe from a distance in this particular animation and went down to the micro, it actually looks the same.
You told me that too. Yes, you said somebody took a picture where you couldn't tell the difference.
I have that bookmark somewhere, so I can share that with you. Yeah,
two pictures about the universe, as best as possible photo of the universe we can see, about the galaxies and cluster of galaxies and how they look in the space. And the other photo made by a neurobiologist, you know, looking in the brain and picturing as deeper as possible into the brain, structure of the connection, the brain and everything on a subcellular level. When they put two photos on the screen, they couldn't recognize which one is which.
Yeah.
They look the same.
For a layman like myself, it wouldn't be hard to not know the difference. It wouldn't be hard to make and draw the conclusion that the universe in itself seems to be some sort of a super brain.
Could be. We have to understand patterns. They work in a small, in a big. So what we see here on Earth, it's everywhere. If we see stones here and liquid stone, they're everywhere. If we were seeing, this is a very good example. We will, at least we can see sun and moon on the sky all the time. And we see that they're round. And we were assuming that Earth must be flat. So we have to understand what is above, it's below. The patterns are the same. Round sun, round moon, we must be round. If we see moon rotating around the sun, at least we can understand that, then we also rotate around the sun or something else. And if we see stones and liquid stone like a body of our planet, that means that the liquid stones and cold stones like asteroids must be also everywhere. The same pattern always works.
I always find it interesting when we look at ancient history. Richard mentioned some ancient history earlier, that so much of this knowledge, as time goes on, we discover more and more. We find ancient documents or ruins or something with etchings on them or something. It's like, wow, it's like they knew all this then. Mm-hmm. It was so simple for them. And here we are, and we're just rediscovering it all. It
seems that we are very talented in ability to see obvious things, as we didn't see that, you know, by seeing, looking at a round moon and round sun, that we are round, as we didn't understand that we are also rotating around something. Now, we also didn't understand that if we are on a stone, liquid stone with a cold crust, that pattern is also everywhere in the universe. So we always miss obvious things. That's the problem.
It takes a bit of maturity for that. I find as I mature, I get more round as well.
I'll be round after Christmas dinner.
But to that point, too, because we talked about time a little, and this is something I think that you could expand on from your perspective, is that we're also addicted to the idea that time is linear. That it, you know, we're always going forward, therefore we're more advanced than people behind us, etc. And what, again, if you just look out into the universe, what do you see? Everything is a cycle. Everything is a rotation. And so it would seem to be more logical, and from what you're talking about, Paul, that these ancient civilizations, they've been through this show before. They've seen this movie. They were at a place, even though they might not have had skyscrapers made of glass, that there was an advanced level there that fully understood not only our relationship to the cosmos, but how it worked. And now it seems we have the most advanced, quote unquote, technology, yet some of the simplest ideas around this are lost on us. And I'm not sure how we get beyond that, because I think you alluded to it, but is there, you know, and I don't think we want to go into a, you know, with NASA, conspiracy, whatever, but what, it seems to me odd that with the level of technology and knowledge that we do have, that these are still questions that are unanswered.
Well, it's not so funny, actually, in one sense, because the more technology we have, we figure out ways to make something really simple. With technology, we'll take something that's a 10-minute task and somehow jam it into an hour, right?
Yeah.
So we have a tendency to think in very complicated ways. It seems to be the nature of our minds. Now, going back in ancient times, they didn't always have the technology to make it sophisticated, so they would rely a lot more, like Mitha says, on what they could actually see.
Mm-hmm.
They would just common sense, because that's what they had available. Today we have so much technology, so much thinking going on, we tend to overanalyze so many things and see the obvious.
Yeah.
It reminds me of a kid that saw a tractor trailer stuck under a bridge, and they're spending all day trying to figure out how to get this thing out, and the kid says, I know how. And everybody is like, no, no, go away, kid, you don't know anything.
Yeah.
Finally, at the end of the day,
the kid got his voice heard. He said, let the air out of the tires.
Yeah.
So then they get, and that's exactly what they did. So we overcomplicate things. But it's funny, because when you hear the explanation of big scientific leaps often, right? Where, let's say, we're talking about the liquid magma theory right now. They're very much like that when you read them in history books, where it was somebody that literally, you know, instead of looking at it from here, they just went, oh, and now everybody got it. And these eureka moments are never necessarily these massive mathematical, oh, I forgot to carry the one. It's just a different perspective or a different shift or somebody coming at it without the same level of thinking that existed before, which is obviously what you're doing now.
You know, our ability to understand the universe and ourself in the universe is also, let's say, victim of the cycles. So in that huge cycles which exist in cosmos, when we, you know, consider everything, there is the cycle of our ability to understand the things. So we also pass through the phases when we can see clearly everything and understand everything, and then we go to the phases when we can't see and can't understand what's going on. So basically what I can see and what I feel is that we are going back to the phase when we are getting more and more understanding of the universe. And this is just like a help to speed up that way.
I want to thank you for answering my questions. It was quite helpful. So I'll just
let's
give up. Anyone else? The next person has some questions.
Please come and take a seat.
All right.
Thanks, Paul.
Thank you, guys.
So whoever would like to have any statement to give or to ask something, please take a seat when it is free.
Hi, good evening. My name is Gerardo, and first I want to thank you for inviting me to the speech and presentation. I met you 4 years ago, and it's very interesting, and they're very nice ideas about, specifically about anti-gravitation, and it's pretty obvious that, yeah, it gotta be somewhere there. Now, my questions are very forward and straight, which would be, reading your book, and with the presentation, to me, it's not clear into what is the lava, the magma, made out of, in your perspective. What elements are they made?
The heavy elements, which made stones.
Which would be?
Silicon can be, you know, iron can be even heavier than that.
Heavier, like what?
All what is heavier than
uranium, plutonium.
Everything from the very heavy elements. The very light elements, but not hydrogen, obviously.
No.
Heavy elements too that we're maybe not familiar with here on Earth. Is that possible?
We like a part of the sun, and most probably from the surface of the sun. Mm-hmm. We don't have all the elements here which sun has. Sun has some heavier elements that we have here, and also the origin. The mother of the sun, the galactic mother, has even heavier elements than sun has.
Excuse me. Okay. Now going back to the mother of our sun, it had
galactic,
a mother and
galactic
it had a
mother.
And then in your book you speak about the great big mother.
That would
have the whole elements, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
In
my book, I was mentioning, you know, galactic mother, like a star which create galaxy. Then we know that galaxies are also formed in the clusters. So there is also clusters of the galaxies. So there is the mother of the clusters of the galaxies. So there is always one star which creates around same pattern like creating the solar system, but create galaxies.
So is that the God star?
And we have discovered what we call dark flow, that all the galaxies are moving on a such a way and pointing to the one single point in the universe. That movement we call again dark flow. So there is the single point in the universe which is, you know, favorized by all the movement of all the galaxies. And we call it dark flow. So in my book, I assume even before the discovery of dark flow, it's very recently, I assume that it must be like a cosmic mother. What is the origin of cosmic mother? I don't know. But bigger stars create smaller stars through explosions, through same pattern, like we have seen, you know, of our solar system. When a star, in going down, down with the mass and volume, becomes so small that they cannot create any other star, then they create planets and asteroids. And our sun gave best shot for that with Jupiter. So Jupiter is the best shot of sun to create another star. And what is the specific for Jupiter? Jupiter is too small. It's not big enough to be another new star. But it's also big enough to have still a liquid melted surface. That's the reason why Jupiter has such a big and dense atmosphere, because the surface is still liquid, evaporating a lot and making thick and dense atmosphere. But all the planets are basically liquid lava, hollow one. There is no gas planets, as there is no gas stars.
Mm. Okay, so your answer is that there must be the biggest, heaviest element should be already somewhere, and then it just fragmented and then start making lighter and lighter elements up to when you're saying
explosion from the stars always are connected to the surface of the star. So what star creates around like a system is of course with the elements from the surface layer of the lava. Of course the deeper layers are heavier with the heavier elements.
Okay.
So in the stars, mother stars, we always have heavier elements than in the planets or asteroids, or if it is the galactic mother, which we see that there is very massive object in the center of the galaxy. And we were, you know, assuming that it is black hole. But because of existence of anti-gravity force, there is no way black hole to exist. Because black hole is just consequence of the theory without anti-gravity force. Mm. So that mother star of the galaxy has the heaviest elements in that galaxy. And of course, her mother will have even heavier elements. And we can just assume how that can go.
Yeah, it would be the moment that, there's just the heaviest element, mm-hmm. according to the, right?
But everything is in change. In our universe, everything is in change. So now we have decrease of the attractive mass and increase of repulsive mass. And that's the reason that process spread the universe faster and faster. Mm-hmm. And everything is in cycles. So we have to understand that also we are in a certain phase of the certain cycle of the universe, which is spreading faster and faster. Then will come another phase when the universe will collapse. So everything is in cycles. How? What run that cycles? We have to discover. But it's also we are in a certain part of the cycle of the universe, which we can see now that it is faster and faster spreading. That doesn't mean that it was always like that and that will be always like that. Now we're in this phase. But according to that logic of cycles, it will change during the time.
Okay. And the next question would be same, pretty much. It's not simple, but it's straightforward, which would be, when you say the planet is hollow, or the sun, or any star, or any system,
except
would be
small are not hollow.
Okay, but let's say it's sun. So when it's hollow, I'm thinking of empty space. Is that how you portray it, hollow, or it's just if let me finish the question.
Okay.
Would be is there just empty space, which would be like, you know, it's on to the studies of physicists, it's
vacuum.
Possible to
there is no empty space.
So that would be my because let's say the biggest the mother of the whole situation, I don't want to name the godmother but let's say something like that would be a little bit more hollow and more hollow and more hollow until perhaps there you find the empty space. But is that what you're going with when you say hollow, or it could be like, you know, a particle, or like a, you know, a muon there or something in there?
Inside the stars, there is the inner solar wind. So the gas is also, because lava boiling also inside, in the inner surface.
Yeah.
And creates, try to create the same pattern like corona, speeding up and warming up. So the stars are more warm from inside than outside. And that process creates, they're like a furnace. And temperature inside the sun is much, much higher than even in corona. But it's the mixture of the gases, and it's also the whirl of the gases, and also some asteroids or some magma which is taken from the explosions, and everything is ejected when openings are, you know, when North and South Pole are open, and then everything is ejected out. So pressure is released. And then again, gravity closes the openings, then again pressure rises, then again is open, and pulsating in a certain frequency. So, but the space inside is not the hollow. It's full of gas, and there is also hydrogen inside created by anti-gravity force, which is, you know, pushed out, up and down. So it's not vacuum. So it's gas and also some asteroids or some lava created to explosion also is in that like tornado inside the star. When planet is in question, because the openings are constantly open on the North and South Pole, that means that it's not hollow, it's not empty, its atmosphere must be inside, the air must be inside. So it's also gases of the atmosphere of the planet is also inside the planet.
Yeah.
It's not vacuum, mm-hmm. That's for sure. What is inside? I hope that those who can explore that will explore that. Thank you.
Any other questions, or do you want to just sort of...
If anybody wants to say anything...
Question. Is gravity constant? Is it a factor of distance from the center, or is the gravity at the center more larger than at the surface? Is there a variable to gravity?
Let me just take...
A visual experiment here. Oh, you're going for the notes. Okay. Thought you were going to do a demonstration.
Yes. So, as you can see, this is the body of the star. The center of the gravity is this black line.
That's the center.
In the middle. That's the center of the gravity.
Okay.
So, because this is gas, and this is anti-gravity chamber actually inside. And this is the center of the gravity. The similar thing with the planet. The center of the gravity is in the middle of this body.
Of the magma.
Yeah. So it's not the center of the star or center of the planet.
Okay.
It's this middle line of the material which creates star or planet. That's the center of the gravity.
So the exact center that would be anti-gravity.
Inside the center is at maximum anti-gravity. There's the maximum temperature and maximum anti-gravity repulsion is in the center of this chamber.
Is there any way to consider a ratio between space and gravity then?
Probably, but that has to be, you know,
so
done. That needs more
places,
work on this.
In some places, gravity is so intense that it condenses space.
Be like a mini black hole?
Possibly.
Black holes are impossible thing, like...
Yeah, you said that
yes,
earlier.
Because
somewhere, so we have distance, but if there's gravity, so there's relationships between time and, you know, gravity and space, and somewhere there has to be a little bit of, what can I say?
That's a good question, but that question needs a lot of work to be done on that.
Three more books.
A lot of work. So the whole story about the we didn't understand that hydrogen would come to existence to the work of the sun, of the stars, actually pushing apart all the galaxies and create spreading. If we didn't understand that, we will not come with the theory of Big Bang.
Yeah.
So the Big Bang is also
in question.
Not in question, it's impossible process. The black holes are impossible because you have to understand that matter is protected from absolute dissolving in the space by gravity. Gravity exists to keep matter together, not to dissolve totally. But also, matter is protected by anti-gravity from the self-destruction. So there is no option that matter can be self-destructed like in a black hole. So play of the both forces keep the matter in existence, and in the cycles we start to see that cycles now more and more clearly, but we will come to understand them better.
What intrigues me is that the surface of the sun is cooler than the wave.
Yeah, that's the absolutely opposite logic than we have on Earth.
So what you're saying about black holes not existing is possible because we have heat and energy sort of transfers. So there's a dynamic system of, as you create more density or possibly more gravity or anti-gravity, you're generating energy.
Yes, stars generate energy inside, which warm them up from inside and keep them warm, keep this body boiling, and then creating solar wind, inner and outer solar wind, by anti-gravity force. That's much more efficient process of creating energy than nuclear fusion, what we believe. Nuclear fusion is not possible because of anti-gravity force. It's not possible. If we increase the temperature of the gas, what we try to do, you know, Russians and Americans were working on hot fusion decades ago, started to work. In different, Russians were doing with the magnetic fields, and Americans were doing with the lasers. And they were trying to create fusion, controlled fusion, and nobody succeeded. Because it is impossible. Whenever we increase temperature of the gas, the mass going to be more repulsive, and the possibility to get fusion is even less and even worse. So cold fusion is allowed in the nature. Nature allows cold fusion. Hot fusion is impossible in the nature because of anti-gravity force. So. Why Americans or Russians or nobody succeeding in hot fusion? Because it is impossible task. Not because of lack of money or smart people or, you know, equipment. No. They were just, and they still work on impossible process. That's the reason of failure.
So see, the consideration that we coalesced out of sort of, say helium, hydrogen became helium, eventually it gathered more mass, eventually it became iron, and so gradually there was this fusion of protons and neutrons.
Yeah,
to the point
there's a still present mainstream theory, you know, standard model, which showed, but that's all wrong. If we can see obvious truth that stars are liquid magma, then everything we assume about the astrophysics must be changed. So we have to forget all that. It's just to forget and to start building new theories which can explain what is obvious. Now we have to explain obvious. I gave big step in this. This is really big thing. For me, it was 16 years needed to understand what's going on inside the star. It was easy to understand and to realize that star is liquid by looking at the photos and videos. Just, wow, this is liquid. But how it really works, That was much, much harder job.
Is there anyone else out there right now that would be close to a consensus with you? Is there anybody that's published, anybody that's at the sort of mainstream academic level that's going down this path?
I have seen one article about saying that sun is liquid. But what I'm talking about here now, it's really, you know, said second time. First time was in the summer when I was giving presentation in OISE, but this is just very, very beginning of this concept to understand how really star works. And basically, what we can see from outside, like pulsars and polar brushes of the sun, just confirm what I'm talking about. And also origin of the
Earth and Earth Cloud especially. It's everything come to again be simple, logical, and obvious. But this is really, really new thing.
So you don't believe in antimatter?
Just one more statement. If we're looking at magma, we're sort of looking at fire, and we're looking at something like, say, rocks at the same time, like burning rocks almost, right?
Boiling liquid rock, which boils.
Boiling. But the thing is that it's on the verge of burning, so it's almost like a combination of matter and antimatter.
What we consider like antimatter is when we have what we call matter is protons plus charge in a nucleus and electrons negative round. What we call antimatter is with the antiprotons, which are negative, electrically negative, and positrons, positive electrons rotating. But even antimatter has gravity. But here we talk about anti-gravity, which is the play of the temperature. So temperature relativity of the mass is the game which matter plays. We have to understand, because as everything is changed by temperature, not just dimensions or phases from ice to liquid to the water vapor when we evaporate, when we heat up the material, it also changes, you know, the electrical qualities, magnetic qualities, structure, everything is changed. Now we have to understand that mass is also subject of change by temperature.
So does antimatter work against, opposite to gravity?
No.
Is it the same effects or is it opposite?
Antimatter has gravity effects like matter. The thing is that because of opposite electricities, if they meet and hit each other, then they disintegrate because the electricities are opposite.
So
we have electrons and positrons. We have protons and antiprotons. Yeah. When they collide, then we just get, you know, gamma rays because of disintegration. But gravity works with antimatter also. And if we heat up anti-gravity, antimatter, it will also has anti-gravity effects.
I just wanted to, I don't know, that maybe, you know, it's not enough time, but, you know, to talk about anti-gravity, because you can talk about negative temperature, could be like minus 5 degrees, right? We go there. But to have like a minus Kelvin would be
like
pretty much
zero.
Right. So they could be. It's like some quantum states that it's impossible to reach. I mean, talking about some factual things about what our limitations are into what we can. Even you can have the best brain, but you cannot really pursue this stuff.
Yes.
Into, say, you know, some weird quantum state of something, and then you find some things that, what you wanna, I guess it's impossible to pull out these things, as you were saying about fusion in a hot environment, hot state. But I mean, coming back to the way the presentation and the idea, right? Because the idea is what is valuable to me. There are things that anybody can just, for certain things, you know, it's not 2 plus 2, but maybe it's like, you know, some exponential somewhere there.
Nothing is really linear in anything we do, you know. There is no straight line in the universe because everything is rotation. You know, the curves are not straight, so everything is, you know, circle or ellipse or some other, but nothing is straight. Also, I want to point the part you were mentioning about the temperature very low, close to what we call absolute zero. We came to absolute zero by extrapolating result of the experiments, and we did extrapolation in the straight line. which doesn't work for the nature. Nature doesn't work in straight lines. So there is no such a temperature of absolute zero. There is some very, very low temperature which can be reached, or very high temperature which will be reached, like extremes, but considering absolute zero, it's again one of the impossible things. So we can go below what we call now absolute zero, and we, I don't know how hot we go, if we go up, you know, in hot realm, how high we can go. But definitely no absolute zero. But I want to mention that Russians did experiments with metal rods. They were heating them up, and they were able to measure decrease in mass with the increase of temperature. So what I'm talking about also has experimental supports. But the clue of the matter, when matter becomes repulsive, is the gas phase. Liquids and, you know, ice and water falls down, snow, rain. Water vapor can go up and down, depends on temperature. If it is warm enough, goes up, create clouds. If it is getting colder, falls down and creates fog. So gas state of the matter is the phase where mass goes from attractive to repulsive. So we have to pay attention, because bodies doesn't disappear because they have become gas. They didn't disappear, but we lose them again from our, you know, sight. We see solids, we see liquids. When it become vapor, we just lose what's going on. But that's the clue, gas state of the matter.
I'm just gonna have to, I'm gonna have to ask if Hugh can come up and maybe we can switch spots, because I actually have to go. So I just want to personally thank you for this. I think it's always cool
thank
to be
you.
Part of history, and I think we are part of history in some way, shape, or form. I'm going to have to read up a little more to understand about 80% of what we talked about tonight.
Okay.
But I know I won't find it on Google, because it's going to be on Gorin.
Will be. This video will appear online, and also we will most probably have in 1 month another event here. And then many of the people in Toronto and even further, you know, around the world will be, you know, informed about this, and public debate will start to be.
And are you
going?
Are you planning on trying to publish?
Yeah, I will contact scientists,
yep.
philosophers, because
yep.
this is not just scientific revolution. This is philosophy revolution.
Yes.
Also, we have to change everything we understand about the universe.
Well, as
it's
we know,
always
yeah.
philosophy included.
Be careful, because as we know, history is never kind to those who try to change it. So for that, thanks for the courage. Thanks for the time.
Thank you.
Thanks,
you.
Guys. So I don't know if there's any more questions. Maybe what we can do, because we're coming up to about 2 hours since we started the show today.
Okay.
We could end the video, and then if people want to hang around and just have a conversation, we can do.
And let's say in 1 month we will have another round, because now this is like I did stand up and I challenge everything we know. But response will come. There is plenty of people, scientists, which see that something is really wrong in our theories. And this will be really seriously considered by them. And public debate will start. So people who even want to be like ignoring everything on this level will have to come to say something about this, because word will spread. And you also spread the word. So that's the part of your job, to spread the word.
And this is the debate right here. We've already started it, and I think we got everybody thinking. And every time I hear you speak, Mita, I'm more and more convinced that this might really be the way things work. And so, and people are going to be watching this on YouTube, and they might want to get involved in the conversation as well. So where can they go? Can you give out a website, a web address that people who are watching this on YouTube can get in touch with you and continue the conversation?
My website is thenewphysics.com. Thenewphysics.com. And you can download book for free and read. But what I did today is further than the book. So you really heard the latest realization of mine in this realm. And also the new website will be created very soon. Domain is already taken, will be antigravityphysics.com. And you will have this video, you will have the song of Sarah on the website, and all the new things we did, animation also is new thing. So everything will be on the new website, and every update will be there. So I accept, I can assume that there will be a possibility to create online, something online, because there is a lot of people around the world which will really take this seriously and want to discuss. And today it's not a problem to create online conference. So the next conference may be even online to have guests which will be appearing on the screen or on this.
Absolutely.
One.
Yeah.
From Australia, from England, from other parts of the world. So do video conference together with the people who are here live in person.
So, yeah. So thanks, Mina, for doing this. And again, thenewphysics.com. And what was the other one that's not up yet?
Antigravityphysics.com, but it's not on yet. Will be soon.
But they could be watching this on YouTube in the future.
Yes, but you watch thatchannel.com videos and you will see.
Yes, thatchannel.com. Thank you, Mina. And thanks, everybody, for coming here tonight. And thanks, everybody, for watching on YouTube. And if you feel this is going to be interesting to somebody, just forward this video on to somebody else. And that's it. And we're going to just hang out now and carry on the conversation here at 160 Bartley. And we will continue. So thanks, everybody.
Thank you.